It happened during a lab course, in a room lined with microscopes, and students with white coats with the lingering scent of ammonia in the air. I leaned over the eyepiece and looked into a single drop of water. It was like a portal to another dimension, filled with life forms I had never imagined, living silent lives in a space too small for the naked eye. It was the beginning of a new journey. As I gazed into that overlook realm more and more, I started to see myself differently. My own cells, my own existence, felt ancient and deeply connected. I was alive and part of life, and for the first time ever, I felt I belonged. That realization has been reshaping me ever since, teaching me the value of life and making me a better person. And today, I want to start sharing it with you. Welcome. I'm James Wise, a researcher and storyteller. You may know me from Instagram or from my publications or from the YouTube show we ended last year. Or maybe you're completely new here. Either way, thank you for being here. Today, I'm starting something new. A series that combines science with story. Unicellular life with poetry. Facts with feelings. Each episode tells us a new epic full of beauty and rare organisms. Behaviors and interactions that defy our imagination of life. Together, we'll explore the smallest wonders that hold some of life's biggest secrets. Let's begin our microscopic odyssey with a group of single-celled organisms I've been trying to find for years. After 8 years of searching, one day I found them. Not in the wild, but in my kitchen. Not with a microscope, but with a magnifying glass I fashioned from the parts of an old microscope. I was looking at the fishless fish tank that sat on my kitchen counter for some years, trying to observe my cladonema colonies and hoping to catch them blooming with jellyfish again. But something else caught my eye. A rather chubby-looking animal. It moved like a bristleworm, gliding slowly on the glass, twitching from time to time like it was startled. After viewing it for a few seconds with the magnifying glass, I was quite sure it was a Dinoilis. Dinoilis are common in shallow waters all over the world. They feed on detritus and can grow up to a few millimeters in length. They are sexually dimorphic, meaning that the females and males look very different from each other. Look at these baby Dinoilis. They hatch from their eggs very recently, but they are still inside the egg clutch, which is simply an extra layer of protection built around a few eggs after they are deposited by the mother. Once they hatch, the females have the characteristic worm-like shape. The males look nothing like a worm, and very scientifically called the dwarf males. The dwarf males lack the digestive system, but their reproductive organs are fully developed and ready to fertilize females, even before leaving the egg clutch. The females live for a few weeks, while the males die a day after hatching. Tragic. Since I collected the samples from the Baltic Sea, I've had a large population of Dinoilis in my tank, but I had never seen one with such girth. I decided to take a look at it under the microscope, so I gently sucked it up with a pipette and placed it on a slide. It was a Dinoilis, but something was very, very wrong with this one. It was infected by the parasitic unicellulars I'd been searching for. Apicomplexans. The Dinoilis was bloated by the spores of the parasite. The number of parasitic cells likely outnumbered the worm's own cells. Just to make the parasitic cells clear, when I illuminate the infected Dinoilis with the polarized light, all the parasitic cells appear with a bluish hue around the golden-colored stomach. I'm not really sure why they appear in this color, but it made it easy to differentiate between the parasitic cells and the host cells. I kept checking Dinoilis after Dinoilis, only to discover that every single one in my tank was infected by apicomplexans. I wasn't expecting to see anything like this. The sight made me uneasy. and I felt relief knowing that pain, at least as we understand it, doesn't exist in this corner of the tree of life. I was deeply intrigued and wanted to figure out exactly what was infecting my Dinoilis population and how, so I began digging deeper into the literature. The phylum Apicomplexa is one of the most diverse and mind-bending groups of unicellular organisms known. All Apicomplexans have a parasitic lifestyle. They have remarkable skills to manipulate the host cell signaling to get nutrients from the host and to evade host's immunity. With these skills, they have conquered an unbelievable range of hosts, from marine worms to insects, bats to fish, even humans. One of the deadliest diseases in our history, malaria, is caused by an apicomplexan. Over 6,000 species have been described so far, but the estimated number of apicomplexan species is around 1.2 million. Most of them are still unnamed, unstudied, and unseen. The estimated number is quite high because of the way apicomplexans infect other organisms. They are highly specialized parasites, and it's common to find an apicomplexan species only infecting a single organism and nothing else. According to one of the estimates, millions of different species of insects might mean millions of apicomplexan species. I had observed hundreds of infected individuals as I was trying to identify the infection in my fish tank. I documented nearly all stages of the parasite's life cycle, but still couldn't identify it. I searched papers, databases, and books. Every time I thought I found a match, it turned out to be something infecting a sheep or a cockroach or a freshwater fish. Nothing fit. Eventually, I changed my strategy. I stopped asking, "What parasite is this?" and started asking, "What parasites are known to infect Dinoilis?" 10 minutes later, I was reading a paper from 1956 in German. The author of the paper was Karl Grell, a brilliant protozoologist and a skilled illustrator. And there it was, an illustration showing all the stages I had observed and some I had missed. The paper was about Dinoilis gyrociliatus and its parasite Eucoccidium dinofili, a protococcidian, an obscure group within the phylum Apicomplexa, with only a few species described. Everything fit, and I had a name. Well, the name was changed in a taxonomic revision to Grellia in 1974. But finally, I was able to dive deeper into the life cycle of Grellia dinofili to see how these apicomplexans invade, grow, and reproduce inside their host. Like the egg and chicken paradox, it all starts or ends with a spore. One of these spores somehow ends up amongst the detritus that Dinoilis grazes on. Inside the thick shell of the spore lies a payload, tiny cells called sporozoites, dormant and waiting. The spore is tough, built to survive harsh environments until it ends up in the right place. If Dinoilis eats it, something changes. Inside the worm's midgut, the spore ruptures and releases 6 slender sporozoites. If the spore ends up in something else's stomach, it may pass through without ever releasing its payload. But inside the right host, something tells the sporozoites it's time to begin the invasion. Once released, the sporozoites wiggle slowly through the gut, searching for the intestinal lining. At the tip, they carry a microscopic set of invasion tools known as the apical complex. So small, you cannot see them with an optical microscope. One part of that complex, the micronines, release sticky proteins to anchor the sporozoite to the host cell. Another set, the rhopteres, gently open a hole in the cell's membrane, just enough for the parasite to slip through. In many apicomplexans, that's where the parasite sets up shop. Inside the cell, wrapped in its own membrane called a parasitophorus vacuole, but not Grellia dinofili. Grellia doesn't pitch a tent inside a cell. Instead, it burrows through, crossing the gut wall and entering the body cavity of Dinoilis, sliding between its organs like an infiltrator. In the body cavity, the sporozoites settle down and start growing. They steal nutrients from the host. This one is growing right next to Dinoilis' brain. After a few days, the growing sporozoites begin to differentiate. Most of them become macrogamons, large, slowly ripening cells, some approaching a millimeter in length, and a smaller number transforms into microgamons. Think of the gamons as the precursors to sperm and egg cells. When the microgamons are ready, they undergo rapid cell divisions, splitting into 12 to 32 microgametes. These cells function like sperm cells. They swim through the body cavity of Dinoilis, searching for the mature macrogamons, now called macrogametes, which function like eggs. Fertilization happens in the open space between organs. The fertilized cell is called the zygote. It elongates and begins forming a thicker outer wall. This is the birth of an oocyst. Inside the oocyst, the cytoplasm condenses and detaches from the wall. The zygote undergoes more nuclear divisions, each eventually forming multiple spores. Then inside each spore, just like before, six new sporozoites are formed. Once mature, the oocyst bursts and releases the spores into the body cavity. When the host eventually dies, these spores spill into the environment, ready to begin the cycle again. This is the known life cycle of Grayleia dinofili, complex, elegant, and vastly understudied. Everything we know comes from a few studies done in the 1950s by Carl Grell. In the 1980s, the infection was briefly used as a model to test antibiotic effectiveness. And that's it. Just imagine how many other apicomplexans we've missed. Whole lineages of parasites hiding in obscure hosts. Unseen, unsequenced, pretty much unknown. And if that wasn't enough, the apicomplexans make it even harder. Every species seems to have its own unique spin on the life cycle. Some use two hosts, some infect blood cells, others prefer guts or gonads. Most apicomplexans target a specific host at a specific time in a specific tissue and performs a specific stage of its development there. As I frantically flip through hundreds of life cycle diagrams, trying to match mine to something already known, I started wondering, why the hell do apicomplexans evolve so many ways to be parasites, and why do they care so much about who their host is? It turned out that the answer lies in the evolutionary origin of parasitism, or better said, origins. The evolution of apicomplexans turned out to be as complex and captivating as their reproduction. Around 800 million years ago, the ancestors of apicomplexans were free-living, photosynthetic organisms, something like today's algae. They lived under the sun, converting light into energy. But at some point, evolution took a darker turn. Pressures shifted, resources changed, and instead of basking in light, some of these algae-like organisms began to steal from other cells. They lost their photosynthetic genes, but kept one key relic, a plastid-derived organelle called the apicoplast that once worked like chloroplasts, but no longer a solar panel. The apicoplast becomes something else, similar to how I started using parts of my old microscope as a magnifying glass. Instead of discarding it completely, apicomplexans fashioned a tool for parasitism from an old organelle. They turned it into a biochemical workshop, used to scavenge nutrients from their hosts. But here is the twist. This shift from free-living lifestyle to parasitic didn't happen just once. It happened multiple times, in different lineages, each converging on a similar parasitic lifestyle. Separate paths, same destination. As host species diversified, so did their parasites. New organisms meant new niches, new vulnerabilities, and the apicomplexans adapted again and again into precise, host-specific relationships. That's why today, host parasite specificity is one of the clearest signatures of apicomplexan diversity, a result of countless evolutionary experiments, all echoing back to the same origin. Back in my tank, I was watching this drama play out in real time. The Dinoilis population exploded. I had never seen so many. but they were all infected, every single one of them. Maybe somehow the parasites were helping them reproduce, or maybe it was just an illusion, a last gasp before the collapse. We don't know. There's no research on Grelia after the 1980s. Just in case, I fixed a few infected Dinoilis for the future. They are sitting in my freezer now, next to the frozen veggies I'll eat, trusting in host specificity that I won't get sick. There's a strange kind of Machiavellian wonder in parasitism, a terrible elegance in its strategies to manipulate and co-opt cellular machinery to profit and proliferate. Parasitism isn't just about feeding or harming. It's about adaptation, survival, compromise, and sometimes creation by forcing species to change and coexist. These relationships shape genomes, sculpt ecosystems, and whisper secrets about how life evolves, not in isolation, but in intimate, often invisible connection with other life. As humans, we tend to look at life through an individualistic lens, but the purpose of life is rarely personal for other species. So maybe the story of Grelia isn't just the story of a parasite inside a worm. Maybe it's a reminder that even in the smallest creatures, living out strange and silent dramas, we can see reflections of ourselves, searching for shelter, shaped by our environment, surviving through unlikely partnerships. And in that, there is beauty, there is meaning, and there is a reason to keep looking closer. Thank you for watching. If this journey sparked your curiosity and helped you see life a little bit differently, please consider supporting the show on Patreon. Your help is crucial for this channel to exist, especially at the early days of the channel, where there are no sponsorships and revenues. For now, I'm the only person behind it all, and I plan to release a new episode every 2 weeks, and the production quality will evolve with time into a more host species specific relationship. Please don't forget to subscribe and share it with a fellow curious mind. See you in 2 weeks. Bye!